Alright, what's up, y'all? It's Liquor Fan here. As you can by the title of today's video, three lockdowns together in NBA 2K25 is a toxic, toxic lineup. So, as you can see, we have me at the point guard, technically, on my 6'8 pure inside. And then we have Apollo and Tanner on their two lockdown builds as well. Now, Tanner's on a little bit more of like a two-way lock, if you will, where he can be a little bit more of a shot creator. It's kind of what we intended for him to play twos with, but he does plan to cap break the build. But long story short, it still has decent perimeter D, steal, block, all types of ability to still ball handle and shoot. With 80 ball handle, 85 three-pointer, again, it will eventually get 93 midi. It only has like 80 D board, but hey, like I said, it's just a little bit more of a two-way build, whereas Apollo's right here, as you can see, is 99 steel, 95 prim, 94 D board, 92 strength. It's got like pretty much everything in terms of being a switchable, versatile lockdown defender. As you can see, this is his new build to be like, you know, utilized for the rebirth. The old one was a 6'8, which is also still very good if you guys wanted to see that in video format. If you guys have been super tapped in with Apollo's builds and stuff like that and been on the channel and you want to see it, I'll definitely have this current one in the video. And if you want to see the 6'8, I'll also post that in another separate video as well. But anyway, as you can see, as for the other squad, they have a classic lineup where it's like a guard, lock, center. So it's a 6'2 right here, as you can see, with like 97 three-pointer. The lock with 97 prim, 94 steel at 6'4. And I have been seeing a little bit of these as well. I think it's for the sake of speed, more obviously. And then also, most 6'4s, even though I don't think this one has it, can get really high three-pointer in comparison to like the 6'7 locks like Apollo's on, for instance. So if you go with like a 6'4, like a pretty long wingspan, or even maybe a little bit ticked down or something like that, you might get elite three-pointer. And those locks have been very interesting. If you guys want to just see in general a top three lockdown build video, I'd be down to post that pretty soon as well. We need to get back to our old roots on the channel a little bit. But anyway, besides that, they also have a center who's got 96 O board at 7 foot. So there are a couple matchups to hunt here. They have a guard and a tall center. So in the way that this lineup works and why we're here in today's video to talk about it is the toxic 3v3 lockdown combo lineup right here. So as you can see, it's switchable between every single person on the court. I can switch with Tanner, I can switch with Apollo. Those two can switch with each other. We can all guard point guard and center. We can guard spot ups. It doesn't matter who. So defense is a given. It's very obvious how this is going to come to us. And as you can see, the ideal situation is to have Tanner on a spot up because he's probably our weakest defender, technically, of the three of us. And as you can see, like me and Apollo, for instance, definitely coming out with the top defense between the squad. But anyway, now as far as offense, right, you're probably wondering, how do you get to buckets? Well, really gritty ball. Like, as you can see right there, I'm just kind of dragging it like myself across the court, and we're able to just get a, you know, open take on the center who went for the jump on me. But now, as far as how that, you know, proceeds into what we're trying to get at here, what really matters is to play great defense to set up your offense so you can get fast break on threes, even, for that matter. And as you can see, this guy's really trying to fade to the corner. He's really trying to get these like fading threes off with the center, just camping the block. As you, and I'm telling y'all, you might think that's corny, you might think it's stupid, you might think he's selling the game. I'm telling you, some of the top pro-am squads, or 3v3 pro-am squads, that is, and then some of the top just 3v3 squads in general in the stage, they're doing this over and over again. They got a tall, well, maybe not a tall center, more like a 6'8 and something like that, but they have a really good rebounding center, just crashing the boards and just staying down, making sure they're down there for the box outs and stuff like that. And they're letting the guard just kind of chuck fades over and over again. However, this side switch everything capability of the lineup makes it so impossible for guards to come off screens looking to fade consistently. Like, look at this. This is the point being, right? If I'm a prim lock and then this is a tall center on the back end, this can't be switched reliably. We're going to have me as a small guard get switched onto the big for the rebounds, and then we're going to have a tall big get switched onto the guard for, like, you know, defending his perimeter shots. Instead, we have the ability to switch everything off the screen right there. Apollo blitzes off the top to the middle, and I'm down here. I low-key could be in the lane on that even still, but then, as you can see, get the second jump and the rebound on the big man, and we're out on the break, as you can see. So all this stuff compounds. There's nothing to attack, there's nothing to hunt, and even these meta teams, like the ones that run the guard, lock, center, and stuff like that, they have nowhere to go as well. But what this lineup is even more so built for is the kind of random ball. And as you can see, Apollo with a nasty steal, I'm out on the break again, and then the two-way compounds, bro, it's insane. Let's come back to that real quick, because I did want to just finish my topic of talking about how this lineup does also allow us to beat the random teams a lot more as well, where they're trying to hunt our guard more so, and they're just like spamming cuts on him and stuff like that. When we play with like a 5'9 or a 6'2, They're doing that a lot, but they can't afford to do that because obviously we have a 6'9", 6'8", and a 6'7" on the court where you're not getting bodied, you're not getting babied in the paint. And then I will say post scores are very rare, but I mean, I think we would still fare pretty well against them. But anyway, yeah, Apollo, nice pluck. And then boom, we're out on the break, 8-0 lead already. And now you're able to take your twos consistently. You could play real like solid defense just in general. The guard's not having a great time. Bro's hopping in game chat now. I mean, I got two way lit up. You can see we're going for the elbows press where I'm on his left, Apollo's on his right. I mean, dude, it's just really tough out here as a guard to like fare well against a lineup like this. So right there, you can see I was playing for the pre-switch, but instead I see the big slips and Apollo stays up. So now instead of switching everything on that, boom, I'm down low, he's up high, and it's just the most unpredictable stuff. Shout out to Brian Flores if y'all know what's going on in the NFL with the Vikings and stuff. But hey, I mean, like, it's very similar to that defense where it's just unpredictability. You have the ability to just blitz everything off like playing sides right here, or you could fight it through. You could even send rotations for that matter, where we can send Tanner down. And as you can see, he definitely does get down, technically speaking, for that rebound opportunity, and we can double crash. And a lot of times, if you want to talk about matchup problems too, like there'd be situations where if the point guard were to like, you know, fade this on the big man or something like that, right? Like imagine this is the guard down here or the lockdown on their team who's like 6'4". Imagine the 6'4 lock is the one down in the paint trying to contend for the rebound, and then they don't have another build who can crash off the corner. It'd be pretty tough in my opinion to fare well on that rebound. But if he were to have missed that shot, we'd have a decent chance at the board. But anyway, into the offensive possession, you're gonna see a little bit of a turnover situation. So like, I try and hit Tanner right there. Tanner ends up shooting that little pullback right there, and then I get the offensive rebound. However, I try and pass out to Tanner, and the lockdown just happens to be putting his hands up and gets a nice stop right there. Now, you can see switchability on at its best as well right here. So like, even though he's gonna fade to the corner and low-key still get open off that, again, they are very hard to stop, and I know a lot of y'all thought they were trolling for like what they were doing early on, but you can see it definitely is very capable to be gotten to. But point being, we were looking very switchable on that possession right there of like being in transition, nothing set up very well. As you can see, this is also sort of one of the things that we're trying to target, where shots on center equal really good shot opportunities, in my opinion. We have Tanner, who's like a stretch big, so when he's shot creating on the center, although it's, you know, a contested shot right there, I'm on free board right there. And again, that's open for that matter too. So like, that's why we're trying to target that center on the perimeter, because obviously he's a 7-footer, he's lacking prim D pretty bad. Tanner's got some good shooting ratings, stuff like that. And when the center has to contest the shot, that means I'm down for the rebound. So it's just a compound effect of a lot of good things happening at once, essentially. So now I get the board. You might even catch the big man sometimes, like, you know, just lacking, and I'll be able to hit the pass back or something like that, because he might play the contest and try and get down on the rebound and get a little out of body with that stuff. So anyway, you can see, like, once again, just a really gritty ball. I'm like getting the rebound. I'm like trying to just get some random putback and stuff like that. I do a nice little spin cycle. You can see Apollo picking up off that pick and roll. He's definitely defending that corner really good. So now he's down to the midi fade, but I got box out. And Tanner, once again, that's the type of stuff I was talking about right there, is double crashing off the corner. Now we're hitting a nice little dot down the court. I got box out on the center already off the speed and us being down. I mean, look at how this compound effect of this stuff right here, bro. I mean, we play good switch defense. We're able to switch and, like, you know, be able to box him up. He loses in adrenaline. I'm down in the box out. Tanner snags the board. We're out in transition off that. He sinks down trying to, like, play, you know, his matchup or whatever he might be thinking on that. And boom, we get a three just off playing good defense and being able to switch that stuff and everything. So, I mean, I'd like to think that this is a very, like, you know, translatable lineup that a lot of you guys could run, because you don't need to have a lot of guard talent to be able to run something like this. It's just good defense and good transition, and then you just find your way to buckets more often than not. But anyway, you see right there, we're getting a nice little stop. I'm kind of bumping him up, and now he's trying to fade to the corner. No go. He gets a yellow. Unfortunately, that goes in, but hey, obviously, you know, he is the 6'7 at the end of the day, Apollo that is, so it might be the easiest matchup for them to target in terms of being in the paint. Right here, I'm trying to get to some random bucket, and if not, then we'll just go straight to Tanner. As you can see, he's going a little kind of, you know, just random ball offense, and then as you can see, he gets the ankle breaker on the center, and then stick shoots the mid-range, and then gets that bucket to go. So again, man, I don't know. I mean, it's tough for these centers to guard him out there. And as far as how the arrows match up, that's just how it naturally is. You know, I mean, we get point guards on me, we get centers on Tanner. It's like the perfect matchups in that regard. So right there, you can see he's trying to just wall up. I'm not gonna lie, it's pretty obvious they're trying to three hunt, so I'm going for the jump right there. Again, he's down in board position, and we obviously gave that up. So now here we are, we're finally set up really good. We're switching Apollo up right there. I try and get in the lane, nothing doing, but again, just good movement, good like ability from them as far as just creating some shots. And again, I know a lot of those like first shots, you might think they're just bad. These guys are definitely good players, you know, the classic skill-based matchmaking in the Double or Nothing event as well. Like, this is some sweaty dudes out here in this run right here that we were playing on the first day of it being a thing as well. So right there, we're obviously willing to give up the slip because we have such a lead. So you may see a situation like this where it's a little bit of like a garbage time kind of inflation of points, where if they just take the slip, they can have that because we have a 7-point lead. We're okay with giving it up. So now we're playing two guys really high and tight. I'm playing his right hand. Apollo's playing his left hand. Now through the bump animation, he's trying to pass that. So if Apollo were a little attentive and the center was very attentive in terms of coming back up, Apollo could have laned it, but then either way, he gets the pluck on the center, and then we're out in transition again for like the fourth time. Fast break points on threes, fellas. Like, it's a real thing for sure. And again, Apollo switching up right there. We're trying to just get real blitzy. Again, we're okay with giving up a 2-point shot. It is what it is at the end of the day. You know, you could even argue, though, that our defense would probably be playing so good regardless that we probably should just, like, you know, continue to play real defense. But anyway, I'm using Tanner as a pick and pop right here, and it's so hard as a big man to guard this stuff. Now, Tanner just misses an open. He kind of messes up the stick shooting. And then they're out on their own fast break. But now we can match up really good positionally just off having so much speed. I'm switching up right here. We're able to get into these contests and stuff like that. As long as Apollo plays a nice box out and positioning, we would be good on the rebound. He still gets babied, though, off that. I guess, like, I don't know, maybe just a little anticipation of jumping and something like that. But either way, he ends up just getting a nice little bucket right there. So now into the offense, once again, a little gritty, a little just kind of random ball. I could have had Apollo on the dot to the corner right there, 100%. But now we go straight into some pick and roll, right? And obviously, this is bad execution on my part. I'd like to think that I really needed to, do the slip a little bit quicker right here, like, to be getting down before the big man could switch. But either way, as you can see, I get to the lob, but we miss it. I mean, I don't know. I just got anchored or something like that, I guess. That's not something that's typical out of my driving dunk rating. And as you can see, I kind of wall up, but now they're out in transition off that. They low-key could have got a really important bucket right there, but ends up missing. You know, not much explanation for that. But as you can see, another lob opportunity right there with the guard down low. And we're able to make offense work, in my opinion. I'd like to think this wasn't even like a perfect defensive display. We definitely still have the guard in check. Big man was able to get to, like, you know, 8 points on four field goal makes on the paint and stuff like that. But still two turnovers, Apollo with some steals. We got the fast break points. Obviously, that led to me getting a lot of dunks. And then me getting a lot of dunks activates my two-way tenacity and stuff like that. And the same thing applies to any of these guys out here, is like, if they get a dunk on the break, it's two-way. So, as you can see, like, overall, we out-rebound them by, like, 7-4. I had 14-4-1 with a block. Apollo had two steals. Like, everything defensively looks really good on this lineup. So, here we are switching back to the builds. We're going to go over Apollo's build, Tanner's build. If you guys want to see mine, I've obviously already posted it plenty of times as well. So, you can check that out on a different video or just the specific one that I actually showed the video itself. But anyway, what I also want to talk about too is, again, just kind of addressing the whole lineups that we run into. So, like, if people come out there with, like, a lot of tall hybrid forward builds and stuff like that, you just outplay them, simple as that. Like, you got to play good defense, and that's what your lineup would be great for if you did run three locks, was the ability to not get babied by anybody on the court. And if you play the meta lineups like that, mix in some rotates better than we did. If you ever wanted to do this, let's actually go back to the game plan. I want to explain this one time and then we'll get to the builds. All right, so when I say mix in some rotates, this is what I mean. So, like, they're on the far side of the court right here, aka they're not hugging the same side as where their corner spot up is. But what I would advise to do is, if you're playing sides defense, very switchable, you want your right side defender to, like, kind of funnel the offense into the left side here as much as possible. Now, granted, a good team could cut their corner all the way through from left to right to replace that and counter it, and that's a very good play. But at that point, then you could just shift the same thing to your defense. You could force them back to the corner side no matter where it is. So, point being, I think whoever, if you're playing size defense, is going to be playing that opposite side of the corner should really take away that right really hard, force the point guard action this way, because then, as you can see, if me and Apollo both played up tight right here and gave up the slip, whoever's leftmost could just rotate to the corner and then the corner could drop down. So, point being, that rotation is going to be unrunnable if it's not close enough. And like if me as the left side defender isn't close enough to get to the corner, the rotation won't work. So that's why you want to funnel their pick and roll movement as far over to the left here as possible. Because if that guard, let's say, was maybe, I don't know, like right here instead of right here, you'd be seeing a situation where Apollo could play a lot tighter, like, on him with me right there. And we'd be able to, like, maybe funnel this over to Tanner and get the rotate. Because again, all three of us have versatile switchability. But anyway, didn't really want to show this gameplay, but I will say it was against a guy who was, like, top 40 in the world on the 3v3 Proving Grounds and stuff like that. But I just figured the video would be too long, and I wanted to show the builds too. So we can show the final box score of this one. I'd like to think we handled our business here pretty good. Point guard went 4 for 10, you know, like they had no other offensive source of any means. And then Apollo, 10 points as a lockdown. Tanner with, like, you know, 3 for 6 as well, 7 points. And then I obviously didn't have a great offensive performance, but still got the boards. I mean, we were up like 10 to 4 on the board count. But anyway, again, 8 assists too, by the way, on 9 field goal makes, which is very team ball for sure. But anyway, let's get back to Builder. And look, I know a lot of y'all don't enjoy the whole yapping thing, like the newcomers to the channel, but I know a lot of people are very okay with those breakdowns and me showing you guys stuff like that with the rotations, you know? So, I mean, it is what it is. We're here to, you know, make videos for who wants to see them. So, it is what it is. So, this is Apollo's build. It only has 50 pass accuracy. I mean, it's not supposed to be great as far as, like, another, you know, option when the ball hits his hands. And that's the point, is that the ball doesn't hit his hands very consistently. Now, I will say, this is the type of build that a other team can get away with putting their point guard on very easily, and that's where, against some of the top 3v3 teams, like the meta styles that they run the point guard, lock, and center, point guards being able to hide themselves on this build can be a little bit problematic, because obviously it doesn't really bring a lot to the table offensively. It doesn't have a crazy cutting ability. It can still do get the job done in that regard, but nothing insane. It's not like going to shoot over him too crazy or anything like that, and it's not going to really do a whole lot with the ball in its hands either. So a little bit limited in that regard. Now, like I told y'all, he did cap break his build to +5 three-pointer. I think if you wanted to make this build straight up, you could definitely do so, because 94 steal is still a decent spot to be. And then when you cap break into 99, you get the legend glove and interceptor. So just expect you wouldn't be able to play like on ball steals super crazy. But what's crazy about the build though is the legend immovable out the gate. So it has 92 strength while also having 94 D board. So it's got everything in terms of the ability to box out. It's got, you know, the 84 block for the paint patroller. It's actually even still got the, you know, post lockdown all the way up to gold. It's got 95 prim D for that Hoff challenger. And then also 94 is what you needed for, you know, legend immovable. So that's why on most builds you will see I justify the 92 prim. But considering we could get the legend immovable and the Hoff challenger on 95, I thought that was well worth going for. And then, yeah, I mean, it's got like crazy speed, good agility even still, 92 strength for that legend immovable out the gate. You can tier 2 something else. You could go like box out beast. You could go, what's cool about 6-7s, you could actually go paint patroller tier 2, which is not supposed to be a thing for a lot of the big man builds. So if you can get the job done at 6-7, this is a really good lock and back end build. That's why I say the versatility of this lineup is so disgusting on defense, bro. It's insane. Like, combine that speed, strength, and agility with like the good defensive ratings everywhere. It's a really good build. And yeah, I get it. The pass act is really bad. If you ever wanted to, actually, you could just like take this down almost as much as possible. But I mean, hey, that's up to you. You know, what you decide to do with these ratings is entirely in your court. But there's not a whole lot more to really improve in that regard. Maybe you could do the mid-range. I think it's going to force close shot up. Yeah, so I think it's pretty well fine-tuned. I don't think you're going to find a really much better use of those ratings, in my opinion, to like take the pass act even lower. So now let's get to Tanner's build. This is a little bit of a revamp of it, I must say. His build actually only has like 74 interior D, which, you know, isn't supposed to be perfectly great or anything like that. And it's only got, I think, 80 D board. So we kind of revamped it a little bit when Bonnie recreated this, and I just figured I'd bring you guys the better version of it, in my opinion. But the plan is to cap break the +5 mid-range to 93 midi. I will say you guys might want to respec that a little bit if you are, let's say, I don't know, making the build, because I would like to think 89 mid-range is probably something well worth going for if you wanted to do that, because then you get the gold set shot specialist. And if you don't plan to have cap breaks early on, you might want to do something like that. Or maybe you could go down to like 82 interior so you could buy back that like three-pointer right there. And then, I don't know, you guys get what I'm saying. You just plan accordingly about these cap breakers, because obviously I have to do that this year in terms of setting my teammates up for builds that are, you know, well equipped for the cap breakers if they're going to eventually be able to get them and they're realistically planning on it. But then if you guys as viewers aren't, then it's like a little bit tough of a translation. So just wanted to, you know, give you a couple options, a couple plans as far as what to go with about that. But let's just go back to the original build. You guys get what I'm saying as far as like setting yourself up for success in that regard. But anyway, the build is 6'9 with a 6'10 wingspan. You could go all the way down to that 94, but the only point for the 94 mid-range is to get the post fade phenom, and we're not really planning to get the post control on this build. So not really in the plans. 230 on the weight to be able to get 85 D-board. If you do get that 85 D-board along with the 85 strength, looking at the gold box out beast, again, the strength itself getting us that immovable enforcer. You got like things like strong handle, brick wall, box out beast, all that. So it's well worth that. 74 vert, getting that silver high flying denier. Agility for no real reason other than, I mean, that, you know, obviously on ball medicine. Then just the 1x rating just to be able to play D just in general. You do want agility for sure. Again, good board, good block. Steal high enough for that silver interceptor. It's not meant to be like a lockdown, but still capable of getting lanes, still capable of playing on ball D when needed with that silver on ball menace and the gold immovable. And then also a good interior defender, being 6'9 with gold post lock. You also got the 84 block for the paint patroller and high flying denier too. And here's what's really cool about this build. So it brings something to the table offensively that the other build, aka Apollo's, didn't. And in this case, it's you get the lightning launch, you get the Zion dribble style, which technically Apollo's does too. You only need 60 speed with ball with that. But at 80 ball handle, you get like Devin Booker aggressive breakdown combo. It's really good for getting downhill movement. And then you also get that Zach LaVine snatchback with the step back animation. And that's what you saw Tanner hitting on a lot of those centers out there. And the silver unpluckable, still a pretty cool little feature to be added as well. And then 85 pass act, it's still capable of like throwing lobs and stuff like that, or you know, throwing outlet passes, etc., etc. Again, I would justify if you guys wanted to go 89 mid-range instead off the rip. I think it's very important to get that set shot on gold, but we could be wrong. I've just noticed that in my teammates shooting a little bit when comparing the gold set shot to like the silver, or even, you know, Hall of Fame. And just the fact that when you have a gold, you can plus one that to Hall of Fame, and then like versus currently as this build, you'd only have it on silver and be able to plus one it to gold. So it's a little bit tougher, but anyway, still got enough ability to dunk on the cuts and stuff like that. 45 standing for the packages, yada yada. And that's what you're getting at with the build. Now, granted, a lot of these are tier like kind of set up to fit me as an inside center and like not be so specialized into dunking or anything like that. I understand when you guys are in more of a 5-out-0, it might be a little bit tougher to justify these type of finishing ratings, but I'd like to think they can definitely still dunk on wide open cuts and stuff like that. It's plenty fine. And then even at that, 78 close shot is still plenty good if you don't get a successful cut or a successful dunk, period. But yeah, I mean, the versatility is still brought to the table. It could still hang with point guards for sure. I mean, you still got the best badges in the game for it, like, you know, with the silver on-ball menace and stuff like that. And point being of being a 6'9", when you're 6'10", you can't get on-ball menace. And then obviously, like, you know, the agility, the speed, stuff like that, the prim D, it all kind of gets tanked down a little bit. You could justify 6'10", potentially. But anything higher than that, it's not great in terms of the planning to, like, be able to guard a point guard. You want to be 6'10 and below, in my opinion, to be able to guard the PGs. So that's what lacks the versatility if you go any taller than that. That's why 6'9", 6'7", 6'8", like, they're the perfect versatile heights in the game as far as what to attack, as far as trying to be able to switch everything. So anyway, that's all video. I know we did a lot of yapping here, but hey, it's all good. Like I said, I wanted to give as much information on something along the lines of these as far as a lineup that you guys could shoot for on your own, because I know this is a very relatable lineup for you guys. Like, it's going to be something that you and your boys could easily do because it doesn't require so much crazy stick skill or anything like that. It's just straight defense and communication and IQ and just understanding that stops equal offense, and you know, easy offense off those stops equals them having to play real offense themselves. They can't run fast break or anything like that either. So anyway, that's all for video. I hope you enjoyed. If you did, feel free to drop a like, sub, and you turn on noties, all good stuff. And like always, try this one to 2,000 likes. If you made it to the end of the video, put lock in the comments to show your support that you made all the way through. And also, if you guys want to see another video of showcasing like the top three lockdown builds in the game, I would love to do that as well. I'm sure you'd probably see a recycle of Apollo's build, but I would love to show you guys like a meta 6-4 lock, or just like true blue meta locks in general, or like even show ones that incentivize the cap breaks, ones that still plan on it not being. And just in general, I think we'll get to those like top three point guard, center, and lockdown builds finally, now that we're like a month into the game. So I'm down to get to that. And technically, we're not a month into the game. We're a month into the content, technically speaking, with like, you know, the early access stuff that we were able to get. But anyway, that's all for video. I hope you all enjoyed. If you did, feel free to drop a like, sub, if you new, turn on noties, all that good stuff. Like always, try to win 2,000 likes. And on that, I'll catch you in another one. Take it easy, man. Peace.